Welcome, viewers. Yi here, professor, educator, person who just loves everything about welding. And I'm here today because I want to talk about welder qualification test plates in Canada. The Canadian Welding Bureau is a governing body for the CSAW 471 standard, and they're recognized throughout Canada, even globally. So I'm somebody who witnesses welder qualification test plates on a regular basis. I've seen thousands of them, and I'm hoping to share a little bit of that information with you, the viewers. So if you're interested in this, stick around. So we're going to talk about these test plates. There's different root openings. There's different plate thicknesses. There's even different joint configurations. So we're going to go through all that stuff right down to destructively testing it. I'm going to go through the standard with a fine tooth comb and work out any of the kinks. There's a lot of information out there. I want to go through the standard and I want to clarify some of this stuff. First, let's have a look at who the Canadian Welding Bureau is. And what does the CSA 471 standard mean for a welder? The CWB, or Canadian Welding Bureau, is a welding and joining organization that administers welding certification, training, and testing across Canada. Welder qualification plates are structural qualification tests that fall under the CSA 471 standard. This standard provides the requirement for certification of companies involved in the fusion welding of carbon steel. This includes qualification requirements for welders, welding procedures, and welding supervisors. You'll often hear from a welder that they are certified, when in fact they are qualified. A welder is qualified, and a welding company or testing facility is certified. Testing may be carried out at CWB test centers, educational institution test centers, union test centers, certified companies, or independent test centers. Structural welders in Canada must be qualified for each welding process and each position performed as separate tests. The qualification is valid for 2 years. A CWB qualification is issued on a card that can be used as proof that a welder, while employed, has a valid qualification. In other words, your tickets are valid while working for a certified company under that process. CWB qualification cards can be transferable or non-transferable, meaning some companies may decide to hold on to the ticket if the employee decides to leave the company. As mentioned, in order to obtain a CWB welder qualification, a welder must successfully complete a test in one of the named test centers. Once signed up, a welder will present themselves at the testing facility where the witnessing and evaluation will be administered by a CWB representative. So obtaining a CWB qualification or welder test plate can open up the door to many opportunities for a welder. So if you're somebody who's just graduating school and is looking to find a job, a lot of time companies won't look at you. They won't even look at your resume unless you have some form of welder qualification, right? So these test plates here can really help you out. The fact is that if you want to weld anything structural in Canada, any sort of buildings and bridges, well, you must be qualified to the process, position, material thickness that that company is using. Like I mentioned, these qualification tickets can give you many opportunities. They're definitely not the end all. However, it gives you something if you're somebody looking to further your career in welding or if you're just getting out of school. Let's look at that qualification card a bit closer. A lot of the information on the card is self-explanatory, such as name, your employer, testing facility, material type, and thickness. Directly under the test center record, it will tell you whether or not your ticket is transferable or non-transferable from one company to another. The expiry date is listed. Your tickets are good for 2 years from the date it was issued, with a 3-month grace period from the expiry date. Mode of transfer falls under either manual, semi-automatic, mechanical, or automatic. The two most common mode of transfers are your manual and semi-automatic. An example for manual would be stick welding. An example for semi-automatic would be MIG welding, or any wire-fed process. Welders must be qualified to each position and process. When looking at class,
Welders must be qualified to each position and process, horizontal, vertical, and overhead. Each position can be challenged in any of the processes listed except for GMAW spray transfer. These tickets are dedicated to the flat and horizontal only. If you're wondering why, just try it out and you'll quickly discover that the high current levels will cause something like this.
When a welder attempts to qualify, the test assemblies are to be welded in the lowest position and progressing to the highest. And that order is as follows. We start with the flat, and then we go to the horizontal, and we go to vertical up, and then we have overhead. So your vertical down is a separate qualification as well. If your tickets are approaching the expiry date and you want to requalify, they offer something called a check test. This is where the welder will come in and weld in the vertical and finish it off in the overhead, and that will requalify you to an all position.
The final bit of information is the classification and electrode type. Classification is a description of the groove type, the two most common being your S class, which is a groove and fillet, and T class, which is an open root. However, other classifications include fillet weld, tack welds, and arc spot weld.
So to keep this simple, we're going to be referencing the GF plate because it is the most common. It's your S-class ticket. This has a 2-inch wide backing bar by 1/4 inch. It has a square side, and it also has a 30-degree bevel.
Let's have a look at the S classification. The most common test plate assembly is the S-class ticket. This means the qualification plate is a groove fillet weld with a backing bar. You have three different options to perform this test. However, option number one is the most common. Options number two and three require the welder to perform a separate fillet weld test on a 6x6 T-joint on 1/4 inch plate. The GMAW spray transfer, SMAW, and FCAW are to be completed on 3/8 inch plate with a 1/4 inch backing bar. The GMAW short circuit and GTAW are to be completed on a 1/4 inch plate with a 1/4 inch backing bar. FCAW or MCAW with a 1/16 filler wire calls for a 1/2 inch plate and a 1/4 inch backing bar. They start with two pieces of 3/8 inch thick or 10 millimeters thick by 3 inches wide and 6 inches long, one with a 90 degree edge prep and the other with a 30 degree edge prep. Your third piece is a 1/4 inch thick or 6 millimeters by 2 inches wide, by a minimum of 6 inches long. I like to cut this one at 8 inches for an extra run-on and run-off plate. The test center is responsible for providing the plate. However, in the event that you are responsible for putting your plate together, it's important that your tack welds be no larger than 3/4 inch from each end. The tacked ends get discarded when processing it for destructive testing. If the test plate is going to be X-rayed, we don't want any tacks in the weld zone. Tacks could show up as lack of fusion under X-ray. Okay, your 1GF, 3GF, and 4GF tests have a 1/2 inch root opening, or 13 millimeters, and your 2GF test has a 5/16 or 8 millimeter root opening. When changing to larger diameter wire with flux core and metal core, the root opening also changes to 5/8 inch.
Okay, so what to expect on test day? A certification service representative, or CSR, will provide you with all the information you need. So this is your welding inspector. So upon receiving your qualification plate, the inspector is going to have a conversation with you, ask you if you're right or left-handed. They're going to mark the stop or stops, and then you're going to return to the booth and you're going to start your welding. You're going to perform your first fillet weld on the square side, and you're going to create a weld that is no larger than 5/16. All right. Upon stopping cleaning up your welds, you're going to return to the inspector, or the inspector will come see you. He will specify. He will examine them, make sure they're the right size, and then you will return to welding. Now, most inspectors won't want to see your plate until you're completed, meaning you've capped it. So once you've capped your plate, you're going to call the inspector over again. He or she is going to examine the weld. If they have to, they're going to use the fillet weld gauge, but they're going to visually inspect that weld and make sure it's within criteria. Okay. So once your plate has passed It is then time to process it.
The test center chooses whether the qualification plates are to be sent off for X-ray or destructively tested. If it's a destructive test, the test center usually requires the welder to process the plates for the guided bend test. This includes removing the quarter inch backing bar, grinding the root and face flush, and cutting the plates into 3 1.5 inch coupons. Once the plates have been bent, the inspector will evaluate the coupons against a set criteria. This process will be covered in detail, along with hacks, hints, and tips on how to pass a CWB plate in part 2 of this series.
Before we sign off, there is one thing I do want to mention, and that is to be nice to your welding inspector. So they're the person that's going to sign off on your tickets. They're the person that's going to give you the pass or fail. So follow instructions with them, follow procedure, and it'll always do you well. So as always, be safe and keep your lenses clean.